The following message is a presentation of Valley Metro Church, a community of believers dedicated to knowing God and making Him known.
Good morning, family. I hope everybody's doing good today. As Christy was saying earlier, I hope everybody had a great Thanksgiving with friends and family and great food. And anybody still getting over their food coma? Yeah, I know I am a little bit. And hopefully what you got to do in that Thanksgiving time with friends, family, is really intentionally stop, pause, and give thanks to God. Because we have a lot more to be thankful for than we think sometimes. And we talked about that last week, about really giving thanks, and what the Bible says about don't be anxious for anything, but all things through prayer and petition with thanksgiving. Let God know what your requests are, but thank Him first. We talked about counting our blessings before counting our needs, and Thanksgiving is a great time to do that. And then here we are right after Thanksgiving, and everyone's getting ready for Christmas now. In fact, today we are in between the two biggest shopping days of the whole year, which was, yeah, woo-hoo's out there, which was Black Friday. And by the way, they said it set a record on sales, Black Friday, and Cyber Monday, where everyone, how many have done Christmas shopping already? Anybody? Okay, some of you guys? Is that it? A few of you guys? Okay, you got to jump in on Cyber Monday then. But anyway, the point is we're in between these two times where a lot of shopping gets done, and there's kind of a frenzy if you go to the malls, parking and everything around gifts and stuff like that. And some of the biggest questions I know that at least kids are asking is what do you want for Christmas? What are you going to get for Christmas is often the question. And then after Christmas, it's what did you get for Christmas? And so there's this big push about what am I going to get? What are you going to get? What are we going to get them? And I was thinking about this years ago. I worked at a car dealership, and I was blown away how many people came in right now at Christmas time and bought themselves a brand new car. Like the big present of the year was for themselves. Merry Christmas to me. And that's cool. You know, getting a new car, I think, is a great treat. But it was just interesting that at Christmas time, the main thing was getting themselves a car. And I think oftentimes people do that. And maybe this Christmas, you're going to pick yourselves up something. I would just want to encourage you that I hope you get great gifts. I hope you give great gifts. But we got to remember whose birthday it is anyway, right? Whose birthday is it? Whose birthday is it? We just got to remember that. Otherwise, we're off on our reason for the season. And that's really, really important. But I think, you know, when you think about what you might get for Christmas or what's on your list or what you hope to get, I think there's always these seasons in our life where we're looking forward to getting something. And it could be something like, say, at work, you're looking forward to a raise. And you're thinking to yourself, well, when I get that raise, then things are going to be so much better. Or maybe it's when I get that new car. That's when things are going to be so much better. Oftentimes, I know I thought that when the iPhone 6 came out. I still have my iPhone 6, but I thought, when I get that iPhone 6, it's going to be so much better. You know, there's always this thing in us that when we get something, it's going to be so much better. We're going to be so much happier. We're going to be so much more content. And in life, there's always things we're looking forward to. Maybe if you're in an apartment, well, maybe if we get into a condo, we'll be so much happier. Or if we can get out of the condo and get into a house, we'll be so much. There's usually in life these things that we look forward to. And there's nothing wrong with attaining things or aspirations and going for goals and praying about what the vision is. That's beautiful, and there's nothing wrong. The Bible says to enjoy the fruit of your labor, and that is fine. But what happens sometimes is we think these things are actually going to make us happy. We really do think they're going to make us happy. And we find out, and parents, you're going to find this out about a week after Christmas, all the rah-rah over the presents. There's sometimes kids, you know, fighting and pulling on toys and not so happy anymore. We realize the things that we think make us happy don't ultimately bring happiness. And the things that we think are going to bring satisfaction and contentment don't always bring satisfaction and contentment. And today's passage is exactly about this topic. It's the secret of being content. And the Apostle Paul knew this very well, and he speaks about it, but he's also writing to a church, the Philippians. And we've been teaching through this book of Philippians over the last 8-9 weeks. And it's amazing. We're looking at some amazing topics as we kind of knock our way through it. And today we're kind of wrapping this book up. And Paul has some amazing things to say that's really important about being content. And I hope that we can take heart to what he's got to say, because not only does Paul really understand contentment, but the Philippian church that he's writing to, they really understand contentment. And Paul's going to say some things to the Philippians in today's passage, saying, you know, you guys, you really get it. He goes, out of all these churches out there, he's like, you Philippians, you get it. And he's like, thank you for getting it. You understand the kingdom of God, how it works. You understand these things. So I would encourage you today, if you're a note taker, you might want to jot down some things, because this translates well in our lives. If you want to understand the secrets of contentment, Paul lays them out for us right here. And there are so many people who go through life seeking contentment and don't actually attain contentment. And it just goes to show that they never really understood what Paul is presenting us. And it's the wisdom of God put before us. It's the ways of God laid right before us. And hopefully we can look at this. So if you have your Bibles, Philippians chapter 4. If you don't have one, there's one in your seat, behind the seat in front of you, or you can use it on your phone, or I believe we'll have it for up here on the screen, but we're going to look at this in sections. Philippians 4, we're going to pick this up in verse 10, where we left off last week. And it starts out like this. It says, I rejoiced greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I am not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content whatever the circumstance. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in every and any situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. One of the most amazing verses in the Bible. So Paul is setting this up today. He's talking about a lifestyle of contentment. A lifestyle of contentment. I would suggest to you this morning out of the gate that contentment is not something we attain. Contentment is not something we finally get to a place. Contentment is a lifestyle. It's a mindset. It's a heart condition. It's God's ways that we adopt. That's where contentment really lives. But so many people don't understand that. And there's mad pursuits that only if, and when we get this, and maybe that will bring it, and maybe we'll be happy if this. And so many people never find it. Some people are waking up at 50 or 60 or 70 or 80 going, everything I was grasping for didn't bring contentment. There's a secret to being content, and it's a lifestyle. It's not this achievement out there somewhere. Solomon, who was incredibly wise, and God gave him all this wisdom, and he started writing the Proverbs, he started out really well. But then he spent many, many years of his life seeking contentment. And he pursued everything. You can read it in Ecclesiastes. And I think everybody pursuing, anybody with broad goals, anybody that has a vision for great things, anybody that in the room, if you've sensed God's calling you to something amazing and you want to charge at it, you got to read Ecclesiastes, because you're going to read a guy who did it all and had it all, who pursued it all and checked everything off the bucket list. Everything. He did it all. And at the end, he said it was like grabbing after the wind. It didn't bring me contentment. And this is a guy who paved the way in front of us, and yet Paul is over here going, I used to live that way too. In the religious realm, Paul was a Pharisee. He was a Jew among Jews. He was in the Sanhedrin, and this guy was like a high-ranking guy. He was very zealous. I mean, he was setting the course for people his age. He was beyond them in the faith, and he's like, that didn't bring me contentment either. But when I met Jesus and started to walk in his ways and understand the words of Jesus and understand the ways, that's when I discovered that there is in fact a secret to contentment, and he begins to understand this lifestyle. He says, I have learned contentment in all circumstances, in any and every situation. Now, honestly, when things are going well for us, it's easy to be content when everything is going well. But when things are not going well, when we're lacking something, when we really feel like we're lacking something, it's hard to be content. So listen to how Paul presents this. He's talking about this with such importance, because if we feel like we're living in lack, If we feel like we're living in a place of need, if we feel like we're living in a place of less than and we don't have and only if, then we are driven, our whole life, we are driven to get the things that we think are going to fix it. And a life like that is not a spirit-led life. It's great to have goals and aspirations and visions and pray and hear from God, but to chase after things, which so many people on this planet do, to finally bring contentment and find out at the end that it's empty, that you come up empty, he's saying, don't be driven by that. These things, they drive us. And Paul says that contentment, listen to this, he says it's a secret, and he says he has learned it. This is what the scripture says. Contentment is a secret, and I have learned it, Paul says. So if you're a note taker, why don't you jot that down first? Well, regarding contentment, contentment is a secret. It's a secret, and it needs to be learned. And not everybody knows this secret of contentment. And not everybody even maybe wants to learn it. But I would encourage us this morning, I want to be a student of the Word of God my whole life. I've spent a lot of years in the Word of God and studying it and going to Bible college and teaching it in a lot of various capacities. But I'm going to remain a student of this Word because it's so powerful. And I am going to remain a student of this right here, that contentment is in fact a secret and it must be learned. And so that's a great place to start because, again, if you think it's the acquisition or the acquiring of A and B and C or these things, and if I just got my ducks in a row, if I just got this figured out, boom, I'll be content. If I just get, you know, this relationship or this job or this pay or this stuff, everything's going to be great. No, those are all supplemental things, but that's not contentment. Contentment is so much bigger than that, but it is a secret and it needs to be learned. And I want to ask you this morning, have you learned the secret of contentment? Have you learned the secret of contentment? Because we have to stop searching for satisfaction through things that can never ultimately satisfy. And that's what Paul is saying. He's like, look, I've seen a lot of stuff in life, and I realize now what does not satisfy. I realize what now, at this stage in life, he's saying, I realize there are pursuits that will not do it for you. You weren't made to find satisfaction in these things. Here's a great scripture that backs this up. Isaiah 55 verse 2 says this. Why spend money on what is not bread and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen to me and eat what is good and you will delight in the richest of fare. God is saying, why chase stuff that isn't ultimately going to bring satisfaction? You're not really going to find joy in it. You're really not going to find contentment in it. God's saying, come to me. I've got stuff for you that is the richest affair. It's the best stuff you can get in on. This is Old Testament, New Testament. This theme of seeking God for truth, contentment, and putting away things that ultimately can't bring contentment are critical. John Rockefeller, he was the wealthiest man in the world. And he was so rich. And somebody asked him one day, said, you know, Mr. Rockefeller, you're, you know, like this multi-billionaire. And by the way, on today's standards, he'd be way beyond Bill Gates and way beyond the Waltons. Statistically, compared to the world, he was way ahead of these guys. And he had all this money. And they asked him, Mr. Rockefeller, can you tell us how much is enough when you're a multi-billionaire? How much is enough? And his answer was, just a little more. Just a little more. Because so many people are driven by that more-ism, just some more and it'll be better, just some more and it'll be better. And ultimately they realize it's not bringing satisfaction, but maybe if I had more, it would. And so many of us go through life that way. When you turn the TV on and the mall's windows are saying, yes, get this, you'll be happy, get this. These are the things, these are the answers, you know? And ultimately they don't bring satisfaction. Contentment is not having what you want, it's appreciating what you do have. And giving thanks for it and trusting God for all the rest. Contentment isn't just getting all the stuff. It's appreciating what you do have, thanking God for it, and trusting God for all your other needs. And we're going to see that that is the thesis in Paul's life in this passage. And the Philippians understand this too. This is a really cool part. Again, we're teaching through this book, and this is where God has us today. So we're going to look at what this really looks like. And you know, for some of you, you're going to go, yes, I understand that. Some of you are going to say, I didn't really understand that, but now I do. And some of you are going to say, I understand it, but I don't want to hear that. I just want to be honest with you on the front end, because he's going to talk about some deep heart condition issues on contentment. And Scripture goes there, so we're going to go there. But the Philippians and Paul both are saying in this display, it's not about having everything you want. It's about thanking God for what you do have and trusting God really wholeheartedly for everything else in your life. And so it says in the passage that the Philippians have been concerned for Paul. And it says not only have they been concerned, that now they're renewing their concern. Now this is important because the Philippians are, again, they're up here. As all the churches in the New Testament, the Corinthians and Thessalonians, you can read all these other churches, Galatians. These guys, these Philippians, they're kind of on this other level. These guys are, they get it. And Paul's got great stuff to say. And there's not a whole lot of correction going on with this church. Paul is just praising them, going, thank you guys for getting the kingdom of God the way you do. And it talks about them, their concern and renewing their concern. And I would tell you this, guys, that there's a major connection between our concern for others and our contentment. There is a major connection between our concern for others and our contentment. Now that sounds like a paradox, because there's many people thinking, if I want to be content, I'm not concerned with others, I'm concerned about me, and I want to get stuff. That comes up empty. There's a major connection with our concern for others and our level of contentment. Self-centered people are rarely ever content. Self-centered people really, very rarely find any kind of contentment, because they're usually absorbed with self and more stuff and more things and my world and my happiness and my... But other-centered people, they just look at life differently. They look at others, and when they see others, they greatly appreciate what they have, and they see that others are not in as good a situation as they're in. Other-centered people have a level of contentment. Paul is a perfect example. He's modeling this in jail. He is in jail. He is chained to a big old Roman guard. When his hearing comes up, they may let him go, they may whip him and beat him, and they may kill him. He doesn't really know. He's chained to a guard, and he's profoundly content, whether hungry or well-fed. He's saying this because he means it. He's an others-centered kind of person. Jesus lived completely other-centered. The New Testament models that. And so the second point this morning, if you're a note-taker, is this, that contentment begins with a genuine concern for others. Contentment begins with a genuine concern for others. You know, as a pastor, I've been, you know, counseling people over the years, and when things come up in life, and this has come up before, where people are just not content and get to a point where, look, I'm not happy, I'm not content, maybe depressed and overwhelmed by, you know, just things or worries or doubts or fears, but not content in life, not satisfied in life. I've always said the best cure for that is a good missions trip. Because a good missions trip will flip your attitude. It will flip your heart condition. Why? Because you take your mind and your focus off of you and you turn it to someone else, like some kids in Mexico or some kids in Africa. You change it, or it's kids downtown or the Dream Center or wherever it is, or you go feed, you know, through Hope of the Valley or something. You take your mind off of your stuff. You look at others. You come back with a completely new disposition. And depression isn't gone away through meds or psychology. It's gone through being Christ-like and taking our attitude off of our stuff, our world, our happiness, my stuff, my contentment, and looking at others. And as soon as we stop being self-absorbed and start to be other-centered, poof, it's like a cloud lifts. It's like a miracle happens. And God's like, yeah, I designed it that way. When you take your eyes off of you and you look to others, this is where contentment begins. So it does begin with a genuine concern for others. And so Paul goes on here, and he says that he's learned that no matter what the circumstance might be, he's learned to be content. And the way he can do this is he's really found a way to trust God for everything that is not, that God doesn't have in front of him or God's not providing. The Bible says this, to seek first God and his kingdom, and all these other things will be added to you. If you put God first in your life, seek God and his ways, all these other things will be added to you. Now, you either believe that or you don't. But if you believe that, and Paul does, he knows I can be content in all situations. because I'm putting God first and I'm trusting God with all the rest. And that's the only way you can trust God, is if you really believe what he's saying. If you believe his promises, you can trust him in the rest. If you don't believe his promises, you're going to struggle and maybe not get in on all these other promises he has for us if we don't trust him. Paul trusts him. And this is what he says, and it's one of the most profound verses in Scripture, verse 13. He says this, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through him who gives me strength." Some of you need to hold on to that one this morning. That's your verse. You need to hold on to that because you've been struggling with things as a matter of contentment and things you know are beyond your control. They are beyond your grasp. You can't change them. You can't make it happen. You can't change the situation. You can't amend it. You can't modify it. You can't. And all you can do is trust God. And I just want to encourage you, hold on to this. If you're putting God first, you can hold on to this. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. God, the sovereign one, the lover of my soul, sees me, knows my condition, knows my position, and I can do things through him. This is the kind of mindset where Paul knows from experience that nothing is impossible with God. Do you believe nothing is impossible with God? I mean, do you believe it? I know the book says it. Do you believe it? Because if you believe nothing is impossible with God, and you believe that he loved you before you even loved him back, if you believe it, then you can say, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But you got to know that he loves you. And you got to know that God is for you and not against you. And you got to know that nothing is impossible with God. Paul knows that. He knows it. He knows, not head knowledge. He knows it in his heart. He knows it in his heart. He's experienced it. He believes it. He's practicing it. He's preaching it. And again, this is something we need to get in on. He's basically saying, I'm content and I don't strive for anything. And I would just tell you this, if you think about some of the things, and this is maybe, I don't know if this morning is the time that you ponder these things, but you might think of this later on today, or maybe you know the answer right now. What are some of the things in life that you are in fact striving for? Striving for. Striving is different than having a God-given vision and an aim and walking it out in faith and pursuing it and being diligent. It's different. Striving. Striving is really trying to make it happen. Striving is just really trying to somehow, takes a lot of energy and it kind of wears you down, but you really try to get it done and maybe it isn't, and you try to kind of control it a little bit and make it happen. The Bible says this, cease striving and know that I am God. Cease striving and know that I am God. It's a place where we learn, instead of striving, we learn what resting is about. And I'm not talking about resting where you're not pursuing your goal. I'm talking about resting where you do your best and trust God with the rest. That's what resting in the Lord is. That's what trusting the Lord. But sometimes there's striving because we're trying to be content and we're going after things. And so many people in life do it. And Paul's like, yeah, I used to do that. I don't do that anymore because I found the secret of being content in all situations. I don't strive for anything anymore. I do my best. I pray. I seek God. I give him thanks for what, and I trust him with the rest because I believe all things are possible with God. And because of that, I believe I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You got to get to the point in your life where you have to come to terms with this in your walk with God, that we are so limited in our power. We are so limited in our capacities. And we have to come to terms, which was stated in the Old Testament, it's an amazing verse, that it's not by strength or by might, says the Lord, it's by the power of my spirit. The stuff that you want to get done, the stuff that you sense God putting in you, the stuff that you believe there's supposed to be expression and fulfillment in life, that things that you were made to do, you got to know that it won't be by striving. It's not going to be by strength or by might. It's going to be by the power of God's spirit. And Paul has gone, yeah, I did it the other way. I went chasing people down and I took it all in my own hands and I was making it happen. That was a train wreck. He's saying, now I know how to pray up and give thanks. I'm anxious about nothing. All things through prayer. I bring it all to God in prayer. No matter what the topic is, I'll be able to say, God, I put that one in front of you in prayer. Nothing's on the side. He's not dealing with anything on the side. Everything is on the table before God. Everything. And he's like, God, I thank you for what I do have. I counted blessings before asking for my needs. And I trust you with the rest. Paul's living in this zone. And because of it, He's content. It's amazing. It goes on in verse 14 and says this. He goes, "Yet it was good of you to share in my troubles. Moreover, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out from Macedonia, not one church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving." Say the matter of giving and receiving. He's like, not one church did it, but you Philippians, you guys did it, except you only. For even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent aid more than once when I was in need. Not that I desire gifts, but what I desire is that more be credited to your account. I have received full payment and have more than enough. I am amply supplied now that I have received your gift from Epaphroditus, the gifts you sent. They are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice pleasing to God. And my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. Greet all the people in Christ Jesus, the brothers and the sisters who are with me, send greetings. And all God's people here send you greetings, especially those who belong to Caesar's household. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, your spirit. Amen. This wraps up the Philippians letter, but look, there's so much stuff going on right here. By the way, the Philippians, he said, you shared in my troubles. It's an interesting term Scripture's using. And what he was talking about is the needs of Paul's ministry, the Philippians got it and came alongside. They recognized it and they began to share in the troubles. To share in the troubles means to recognize a need and enter the solution. That's what it means to share in troubles. To recognize a need and to share in the solution, God's solution. For an example, some years ago, about 10, 11 years ago, as when we just started the church, somebody came to us and said, "Hey, listen, there's some orphans in Africa, and they're in AIDS-affected areas where they don't have parents, and a lot of people in their community are dying. These kids don't have a great shot. Would you be interested in sponsoring some?" So as a church, we took a look at these kids, and we're like, oh my goodness. Compared to many other places in the world, these kids don't even really have parents, so they're in major need. And we recognized their trouble. As he's saying, you shared with me the trouble. We didn't just recognize the trouble and go, "Lord, pray for these kids. Please fix it for them. I got to go shopping right now. Fix it for these kids. I got to go get myself a gift." We didn't do that. We said, "Lord, we're looking at these kids," and it broke our heart. God broke our heart for these kids and their life and their situation. We prayed about it, and as a church, we stepped in and said, "We'll take this one and 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 this one," and we took 15 kids. And by the grace of God, and for those of you who support the ministry here, we have been able to, for 10, 11 years, provide these kids with meals and shelter and medication and Christian training, leadership, and in Bible-based programs, and they're even learning entrepreneurship, how they can start their own little business, making beads and selling them in the market. I mean, these kids have gone from here to this age right here, but it starts, guys, it starts with sharing in troubles. And sharing in troubles is recognizing a need, but not just praying about it, entering into the need. There's a big difference. There's a big difference between believing in the gospel and partnering with the gospel. There's a big difference in believing in compassion and entering into compassion. And Paul's saying this about this Philippian church that he's going, "You guys are amazing. You guys get it." And it's in the text right now. And as we wrap this passage up, we got to cover what this means, the heart condition of what this means. So here's the third point this morning. If you are a note taker, I'd encourage you to write this down. The third point is this: see the ministry need and enter into God's solution. See the ministry need and enter into God's solution. You will be surprised how much of your contentment rides on this. You might think, "No, that's not my contentment. That's something over there." You're going to see in a minute. Guys, if you don't have place for this in your mind and your heart yet, today, I believe prophetically God's saying, start making place for this. Remember when Jesus came, there was no room at the inn? I think we do the same thing. We have these little areas where you're like, "Yeah, I don't got room in that area." Here's an area of the kingdom of God, of a fuller expression of your walk with Jesus Christ in how you can express the kingdom of God in the full nature and walk in a contentment that the Philippians understand, Paul understands, and you and I are students learning the secret of contentment, as Paul is, and to see the ministry need and enter into God's solution is a key step. And we're going to see why in a minute. But when you begin to partner with God, God opens up a whole other set of things that you and I could not break through. There are barriers we cannot get through. But when we put God first, when we seek God first in his kingdom, then he opens these doors and gives us desires of our hearts. That's throughout Scripture. I'm not saying this. The Word of God is saying this. And the Philippians get this. And he's like, Philippians, thank you. You guys get it so well. So see the ministry need and enter into God's solution. Now, Paul, then he goes on and he elaborates on how they shared with him in his trouble. And Paul says this, you shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving. The matter of giving and receiving. Now, first take note of the order. The matter of giving and receiving. I would say the matter of giving and receiving matters a lot because Scripture has a lot to say on it. You know, this is typically a message that I would rather share as a guest speaker somewhere else. Any of you who know me personally, I don't like talking about what we're about to get into, and God is telling me get over it. God's telling me get over it because my job, my role as a pastor is to teach the full counsel of God's Word. Everyone say full counsel. Full counsel, everything. Things about the Word, things about the Spirit. What is sin? What is blessing? What is compromise? What is God's way? What is being led by the Spirit? What's God's will, his mission, his aim for our lives? It's the full counsel of God's Word. And this starts to break into a realm where sometimes we don't want to hear this. Some of you going, I get it. I totally get this. I understand. Yes. Others are like, I didn't really hear it that way before. But then there's others of you that are going to go, I don't want to hear this because I don't want to change in this area. And I want to encourage you, if you're going to grow as a Christ follower, you got to hear this morning. You got to hear this. Paul says this is how they saw the trouble, entered the solution. It says, you shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving. And I want you to take this note. The order is this. It's giving and receiving. The matter of giving and receiving. Paul is talking about us receiving from God after we give to God's purpose. Let me say that again. Paul is talking about us receiving from God after we give to God's purpose. It's the matter of giving and receiving. And the reason this is important is because there are certain things in our life that we are pursuing and going after, and we're running into walls and they're not happening. And I believe they're not happening because God is not first in our lives. Oh, he's generally, in theory, he's God, you know, and we love God. But is he really first? Practically speaking, is he really first? Does it really quantify that way with our time, our talent, our treasure? Does it really look like that? Because if we put God first, there's a whole nother level of breakthrough. And he's talking about receiving from God after we give. Now, all that we have, everything we have, is from God. Your birthday is from God. The gifts that you have are from God. The talents you have are from God. I would say the job you have, and you might say, well, I interviewed for that job and I found it. Through God's sovereignty, he allowed you and gave you the car, the vehicle, and the mental capacity to interview for that God. Everything you have, you look at your fingerprint, only you have that fingerprint. 6 billion people on the planet, no one's got your fingerprint. That's God. That's his sovereignty. That's his stamp on you. Everything we have is from God. And the Bible has a lot to say about stewardship, which is really what we do with God's stuff. Stewardship. There's a whole parable about it, many of you heard, where he gives out the talents, the resources, and he comes to check back later and go, how did you do with my stuff? And some people are like, I just buried it. Other people are like, well, I tried to do this and it got a little bit better. Bravo, bravo. What are we doing with God's stuff? That's what stewardship is. Being faithful with all that God's entrusted us. And Paul is saying this. Paul is telling the Philippians, you got to understand this. Paul is saying the gift that you gave was really a gift to the Lord. And the Philippians are going, no, I think it was a gift to you, Paul. No, it wasn't. The gift you gave was a gift to the Lord. And this is kind of a paradox mentally. Like, what does that exactly mean? Jesus said this, guys, in Matthew 25:24. Whatever you did for the least of these, you did it to me. And we're thinking, no, I didn't feed you, Jesus. Believe me, I never saw you on earth. I mean, I believe, I know your presence. Whenever you did it to them, you did it to me. How could that be? When you visited them in prison, you did it to me. When you gave clothes to the naked, you did it to me. When you gave food for the hungry, you did it to me. When you shared the kingdom, when you gave to the kingdom purposes and cause, you did it to me. And we're like, I didn't know we did. And that's exactly what it says in the final conclusion of life, the way he's laying it out. He's like, yes, all those times you did it to me. And he's telling the Philippians, he's like, the gift that you thought it was a gift for me, it was a gift to God. And he goes on saying, I'm not looking for a gift. Listen what he says here. I'm looking for what may be credited to your account. Now, if I were to ask you this morning how many accounts you have, how many people have one account, checking account only? Checking account only. How many have checking and savings? Two accounts. Two. How have an extra one, maybe a 401k or something? Three accounts? Anybody three accounts? Okay. I guarantee one thing, whether you have a college plan for your kids or you got a 401k retirement or you got a checking or savings account or whatever these things are, I guarantee one thing, you know how many accounts you have. Do you know how many accounts you have? You know how many accounts you have. Well, guess what? You got one more. And you might not have known of this account. You have an extra account. And you might not have known about it. But you need to know about this account because this account is profound. The Philippians know about this account. And Paul knows about this account. I have one and you have one. And this is what he's talking about. He goes, what you didn't give to me, you were given to God. And he goes, what I'm looking for here is what would be credited to your account. Now, this account is amazing. And I don't know if you know what your account is looking like, but we all have an account. You do know what your checking account looks like. How many know and wish they didn't know what their checking account? Okay. But this account, do you know what it looks like? Never checked about. Didn't even know I had one. Well, you do. You got this account. And Paul is talking about being credited to the account. Paul is saying, when you share with the ministry the purposes of God, you are giving to God who will reward you. This is what he's saying. This theme runs through Scripture. Again, it's a part of our life that's, I don't want to hear that. I got to go after my stuff. I don't want to know about that. I'm just telling you, this is a kingdom fact. This is a kingdom principle for your contentment and mine and the blessings of God and God doing the things that you and I simply can't do no matter how hard we strive. The blessings of God transcend what you and I will ever be able to pull off in life. And you got to come to terms with that early, and this is a key factor in that. So hopefully you have a large account in the heavenlies full of God's blessing. Every time you give, God credits your account is what he's telling them. That's what he's telling the Philippians. And we have to cover it because it's in the book. And this is how we wrap this letter up. It has a lot to do with gifts going into your account, resulting in God's blessing to you for you putting God first. It's the matter of giving and receiving that the Philippians had down so well and Paul understood so well. And we're learning it too as part of our contentment. The fourth point this morning is this. God knows, sees, and rewards when we put him first. God knows. We can say what we want about God. I believe, I trust, I've been following. That's beautiful. That's a beautiful confession. But God knows, and God sees, and God rewards when we put him first. He always has, and he always does. And this matters because there are things in life that we're striving for that may not ever happen. I talk to people with some struggles from time to time, specifically in the area of finances. And I have to ask this question. Are you putting God first? Well, no, because I don't know. It doesn't matter what the excuse is. There's a lot of them. I'm on unemployment. If you're on unemployment, tithe on your unemployment. Well, I only get my tax return. Tithe on your tax return. We tithe on our tax return. Tithe on everything. When you put God first, you can stand on his promises. But if you don't put God first, we're missing some promises, guys. And we're striving to get stuff done, and yet we don't have God's blessing in an area. This is what I'm trying to tell you this morning. I really hope and pray that there's things accredited to your account as well, and I mean this sincerely, and it's easier for me to share this in some other church than here. And if you're a guest this morning, go home and apply this where you're plugged in. You have to. Wherever you're from, wherever you're plugged in, if you're visiting this morning, you have a home church somewhere else, This is the kingdom of God. You got to grow through this step. Don't walk around this one because you'll always be struggling with contentment and always be wondering, is there a blessing? Am I missing out on it? And what we're doing is we're choosing to sidestep that one instead of saying, God, it is your word. I'm going to hold on to it. But God knows, he sees, and he rewards when we put him first. Listen to this scripture, Mark 12:41. This is pretty amazing. This is what it says in Mark 12:41. It says, Jesus, with the apostles, he wanted to teach them something. It says, Jesus sat down opposite the treasury, the offering box. Jesus sat down. He went up to the temple with the apostles. He sat down and watched the treasury, the offering box. Sounds pretty bizarre, but Son of God is watching. And he watched the people putting money in the offering box. And from there, he went on to talk about the widow's mite. He was talking about rich people putting in stuff that didn't really amount to much because it wasn't much of their heart that they were putting in, even though it was a lot of money. And he talked about the widow who didn't have much but put in so much of her heart when she did that. And he's saying, bravo, see, this isn't about the amount. It's about the portion of our heart that we're investing in God and his kingdom, and it's about the treasures and the blessings that God has in our account. Jesus makes a whole example out of the widow over a nickel. Jesus, why are you talking about a nickel? Isn't this about giving and getting a lot of stuff? No, it's not. It's about what's credited to your account. And that nickel is worth millions in her world. Where she came from, that's worth millions. And the thousands that these rich people put in, that's like pennies compared to their heart condition and what they, does that make sense? But Jesus sat at the treasury and he stood and he watched the treasury. I would say the same thing is true in the matter of giving and receiving. God knows he seeds and he rewards when we put him first. And there are some things in our life that we're going after that we would hope for that won't happen, I believe, if we don't put God first. And he's got more to say about that. So Jesus is saying that God is measuring. God is measuring. Why is God measuring? Because he's adding things to your account. This will be credited to your account, Paul said. I'm not making up this terminology, this concept. If you do this, put God first, these things will be credited to your account. If you don't, they can't be credited to your account. This is it's the economy of God. Everyone say the economy of God. It's different from the economy of man. But you can trust in God's economy, man's economy. We're trying to print more money and we got economies, stock markets crash with stuff going all over the place. Listen, God's economy, you can bank on it. Paul's learned how to trust in God's economy. And this is really, really important. But he sees all. God credits your account when we share in the matter of giving and receiving. And then it goes on, another matter of giving and receiving. Here's another scripture I want to share with you really quick. Luke 6:38. This is Jesus talking about the matter of giving and receiving and how it works. So this is throughout Scripture. It's Old Testament. It's New Testament. It's even before the Old Testament was law was established with Abraham. This principle of God first with our first fruits. Everyone say first fruits. First fruits is first things, not chump change left over. Let me look in the bottom of my purse and see if I got me $2. That's not a first fruit. That's a tip. Putting God first in your life is hard for some of you. I realize that. It's hard for many people. But the Bible says where your treasure is, your heart is also. And so it's hard because I'm going right to the source. I'm going right to ground zero this morning. Some of you are like, thank God for saying this. I've been doing it and I wish everybody would do it. Some of you like get it. Others are like, I didn't know this was in the Bible. I didn't know it was really that important. I understand now. But some of you are still struggling and you're a little mad at me this morning and wish the sermon would be over because you don't want to hear this. I'm just being honest because why it hits home. And I remember when it hit home with me. I remember when I was sitting in your place hearing this topic going, well, why are they saying it? Do they just want to try to buy like some chandeliers? Is that what they're trying to do? I mean, I did. I'm a kid from New York where people would steal your lunch on the way to school. If you were, I'm like, so what's the deal? They try, you know, and I was trying to figure it out. And I heard stuff like this to the point where I said, you know what? I do believe in Jesus and I follow him, but I'm not doing the word. I'm not all in. I'm not wholehearted. I can't really say God is first in my life. I'm going to have to try this and trust. And I took the step 20-something years ago, and I've never looked back. And Christy and I, when we got married, we talked about this, and we go, this is the way we're going to roll on everything. All first fruits on anything that comes in. The first, not the last. The first goes out. So when we put God first, we will tithe before we pay rent, a mortgage payment, a bill. It's the first thing. Why do we do it that way? Because if we try to look for it afterwards, we're going to look to see what's left behind. And that's not blessable. God doesn't bless the leftovers. God blesses the first fruit. The term of first fruits throughout the Bible, again, this is a little, you know, maybe stunning for some of you guys, but I'm just telling you, this is the way the kingdom works. This is how things are added to your account. This is the matter of giving and receiving. And there's God can give you some things that you'll never be able to attain on your own. You need God's favor. You need to do life God's way. You got to be in God's economy if you want to walk in the contentment that God has for you. And so the Philippians get it. Paul gets it. He's wrapping up Philippians this way. Just want to share these last things. Luke 6:38 says this. Give, it's the matter of giving and receiving. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use it, it will be measured to you. This is Jesus Christ saying this. And this isn't like, well, who came up with that statement? Jesus Christ came. The one watching the treasury said this. He's like, if you give, the matter of giving, receiving, God first, if you give, it will be given to you, but not just given back. It's not like lending God $100, you get your $100 back. And by the way, you don't give to use God as some kind of vending machine. God's the sovereign, almighty, loving God. This isn't, well, if you give this, you're going to get that back. And if you hear on some TV show where you give 10 and God gives you 100, shut the TV off quickly. Find the remote, block that channel. The Bible doesn't say that, but he does say he will pour out blessings on your life. And I don't know what area they're going to flow, but they're going to flow. Because when you put God first, this is simply what he does. When you give, it will be given to you a good measure, pressed down and shaken together. That's like your bucket. You know, when you shake it, it goes lower, right? You get more in there, you shake it, and it goes lower, pressed down, shaken together, and still overflowing. In other words, God outdid you. God outdid me. In return, God does way more for us than we could ever do for him. But this is not a matter of if our motive or agenda is to give to get from God, our motive is wrong. This is simply adoration. This is simply God deserves everything we have is from him. And that was my tipping point. I thought to myself, is really everything I have from God? No. What about this? I worked for that. And I said these things. I worked for that. And I moved out at 16 and I was working so many hours a week. And I went down this list of these things and then I started to realize, who gave me the birthday? Who gave me the talent? Who gave me the capacities? Who gave me, oh, I guess he did give me all those things. And I guess the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, amen? I guess it really is that way. I guess it really is. And if it is, then who am I to hold back from the first fruits? But if you're still the other way, like I was, I just pray you sit in God's presence with his word and reconcile who it all belongs to. Because when we put him first, he gives back. We reap what we sow. Last couple of scriptures, and we're going to be wrapping this up. Deuteronomy 14:23 says this. Listen, in the Living Bible translation. The purpose of tithing is to teach you to always put God first in your lives. Deuteronomy, this is 3,500-year-old scripture. The purpose of tithing is to teach us to put God first. To me, it kind of proves it. I can say this, I can say that, but when it comes to like writing a check, it's proof. It's a proof of a big section of our heart. Proverbs 3:9 says this, honor the Lord by giving him the first part of all your income. This is a very old historical thing. Now, I have to say this, that before there ever was a Jewish law, Abraham, before there was any Moses in the law, Abraham was already tithing in the Bible. Then under the law, we see that it's the way we prove our trust and we give to God first. And then Jesus in the New Testament, in Matthew 28:23, said, continue in the tithe. Jesus the Christ, who tells us these things, said to continue in these things. So the last thing I want to share is this scripture out of Malachi 3:10, because this explains the matter of giving and receiving probably than any place in the Bible. It says this. It says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be room enough to store it. God is saying, test me. If you're struggling with the idea, if you're struggling with the concept, if you can't get your head around trusting God in this area, God is saying, and it's the only place in Scripture he says this, test me. Try me. Test. God is saying, test drive me on this truth right here. If you don't believe it, here's the keys. Take it out for a test drive. Run it up and down the freeway. and come back and find out. This is what God is saying. It's a pretty bold thing for God to say. He says, bring the whole tithe. And a tithe means 10%. That's what tithe means. So if you're learning and you're starting somewhere and you've never even given 1%, we'll start somewhere, but know that the tithe is where you want to get to. And by the way, tithing, guys, is not a matter of going to heaven or hell. This is not, we don't buy our way to heaven. Heaven is a free gift of grace, not by works, okay? We come to Jesus by faith and faith alone for salvation. Yet, the blessings of God and the floodgates of heaven open in your life and what he credits to your account is in another category in Scripture, and Paul's talking about it. He's saying there's this matter of giving and receiving that's on a different category. Heaven's free, eternity's free, but God's blessing on earth is different. And so the tithe is the first 10%. It's the first fruit of everything. The Bible says it belongs to the Lord, and giving back is simply being obedient. Here's our last point this morning, guys. There are some of you that are not content in the area of your finances. Maybe you're content in your relationship. Maybe you're content with your health. Maybe you're content, but you're not content with your finances. I understand that. Here's the fifth point. We'll be content in our finances when we consecrate our finances. When you consecrate means you give them to the Lord. There's certain things in your life. Relationships aren't going good. Let's try putting them on the altar, giving those to God. Watch what God does with relationships. Finances are messed up. Let's start doing those God's way. Putting him first and watch what he does. God says, test me. Anything in your life that isn't going the way you want it to go and it's not bearing the fruit, take it and put it on the altar. Consecrate it and begin to do it God's way. And that's why it's one thing to say, he is the way, the truth, and the life, and I want to learn to follow him. Beautiful. But along the way, along the journey, we realize, I know I do, I trust you do, you find an area of your life, you're going, I don't know if I consecrated that area. And you take that area and you put it on the altar and do it God's way. It could be the way you parent your children. It could be the way you engage in your entertainment. It could be, there's so many areas, and things come up and you're like, yep, it's time to take that and consecrate it and watch what God does. We'll be content in our finances when we consecrate our finances. The Philippians here, they're faithful. They've invested in God's kingdom. They trusted God for everything else. Again, there's a big difference between believing in the kingdom of God and investing in the kingdom of God. Big difference. And the picture here, the last picture I want to share you is this picture of Cain and Abel. You know the story. In the Bible, Cain and Abel, but way before there was a law, way before there was any law written. This is throughout the entire Bible of putting God first with first fruits. And Cain and Abel are making their offering to God. And Abel takes first fruits. He takes from the best of his flock. It's like God gets the best. He's getting the first. And Cain's like, so what do I got to do? My brother's over here doing this. What do I got to do? All right, let me find something to throw on the fire. And he goes over and pulls something out of the ground with dirt on it. Throws it on the fire. Maybe it'll burn. And Abel's sacrifice is going straight up to God. The picture is God going, that's beautiful. I see your heart. I see the sacrifice. That is beautiful. It's a pleasing aroma to me. And Cain's, it's last minute, throw this out of the ground. I'll just throw that on there. Maybe it'll do something. Here, God, there's mine. And that one, the smoke's going crazy. God's like, and God comes down and's like, what's going on? And Cain is upset with his brother. Listen to this. He's upset because his brother is blessed. Abel is living a God-first lifestyle, and his brother is blessed. And Cain, instead of looking at his own life, going, what do I have to do to be blessed and be right with God? He just gets angry at Abel. He gets angry, and he takes vengeance on his brother. And God shows up and says, Cain, don't you know that if you do what is right, things will go well for you? There's blessings awaiting everybody. If you do what's right, there's blessings. And it's a matter of understanding. And in this context right here, Abel understood the fragrant thing for God and what was pleasing. And Paul concludes this letter to the Philippians, and he says, by the way, Philippians, your offering, the offering you did, it's an acceptable gift, a sacrifice, and it's pleasing to God. Paul is writing this letter under house arrest. He's chained to a Roman guard. But he's got visitors coming and going all day long, and he's sharing the kingdom of God with them. You know who else is coming? People that are actually in Caesar's family. Caesar, the ruler of the Roman Empire. There's people in his family that have got to come and visit Paul in this rented house. And the reason that they came and visited Paul is because he's in a rented house and it's accessible. And the reason he's in a rented house and not a stinky dungeon is because the Philippians said, we see the need. And we don't just believe in the kingdom, we want to invest in it. And Paul, we're invested in the kingdom. And Paul's saying, thank you. It wasn't a gift to me, it was a gift to the Lord. And it's being credited to your account. And he goes on to conclude the letter. There's even people now in Romans, in Caesar's household, that are now in the faith because of your gift. And by the way, your gift was a fragrant aroma to God. Do we understand how this whole thing works, guys? There's a connection. We can't disconnect these things of contentment, heart condition, God first. It all goes together. And Paul is explaining it beautifully right now. So as the worship team comes up, we're going to close out in prayer. I just want to encourage you guys in this area. I want to encourage you with this challenge. Would you consider yourself to be a God first person? And if not, then today's the day to become a God first person. Say, God, I want to follow you. I want to trust you. I want to walk in your ways. Some of you have been walking with God for quite a while, but I want to challenge you in this area. Are you a God first person in the area of your finances? Have you taken your finances and consecrated? It'd be like taking your wallet and going, okay, putting it on the altar today, God. Never did it before. I'm putting it on the altar today. So many will go, nope, not that. I'll pray and I'll read my Bible, but I am not dropping it. No, I can't do it. I'm not going to drop it. And the reason is, because we believe it's mine. It's mine. And I got to make my stuff happen. So it's going right back here. Or the earth is the Lord's and everything's in it. It's yours. You gave me the talent. And when you begin to do this, you're going to find a whole new level of contentment in your finances. Don't give to get. Give because God is worthy. Amen? But I will tell you, he says, test me. And when you test God, he's going to open up provision and blessings for you. We were doing this, and I always got to share this testimony of our home. We were, you know, putting God first in some up times and some down times. And we even kept God first. And we get a call one day, and I just got to share this testimony because it blows me away. We get a call one day from a broker. We got 7 people living in a little house over here in West Van Nuys, and I got a special needs son. He's getting a power chair, won't even fit in a doorway. It won't go anywhere, the steps. It's just, so it's fine. We're content. We are content where we're at. And we were not looking for a home. We were content. But God saw that we were God first people. And God moved on some broker's heart to call us out of the blue, and said, I'm calling you about the listing. And we're like, we don't even know who you are. He's like, I'm returning your call. Me and Chris are like, we didn't call anybody on any listing. Who are you? He's like, well, it's this house up here with a large lot and a pool. Well, don't look a gift horse in the mouth, you know, Maybe God's, what is this call? So we go up and look at it. And this house was a wreck. It needed a lot of work. But wow, did it have potential. And then we asked how much it was. And we're like, oh, no, you've got to be kidding me. Even in disrepair, we were so far away. We're like, but you know, wait a minute. We have been putting God first. And we have been faithful. And maybe God is blessing us in some kind of crazy way that doesn't make sense. Maybe now's the time to trust in the Lord and lean not on our own understanding. So what does faith do? Faith acts. Faith acts. Faith just doesn't think. Faith acts. So we go, well, why don't we write an offer? Now, this is going to be crazy, but it's about $200,000 under what they're asking. $200,000. Talked to a lot of real estate people. They never heard of such a thing. But we did it in faith and a prayer. And I will tell you, we've been God-first people in these areas. And God did something abundantly and immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine. We couldn't have made that happen. I could have strived and taken on extra jobs and done. This wouldn't have happened. But God made it happen. Because when you put him first, he opens floodgates. There is a press down, shaking together. Don't sit there and try to, if I do this, God will. No, God first anyway, because he's worthy of our praise. He's the sovereign, loving God. But when you do, amen, test him, when you do begin to engage the matter of giving and receiving, when you do begin to consecrate, here goes. When you do begin to walk in faith, you're going to find that God is faithful. Amen. And you're going to find that God will never leave or forsake you, and he's not going to let you down. Guys, I want to encourage you. Paul got this. He was content. The Philippians got this. They were content. I pray you take this to heart. I pray if something's stopping you from being a God-first person in the area of finances, get together and do business with God and ask him what it is. But I also want to pray that if you will take this step of faith and trust God, you, the area of finances, you are going to be content because you won't be striving and you'll know I'm doing my best, God, and all the rest is you. You will know that. You will be able to be content in every situation because you will know that everything else is up to God because you're doing your part. So I want to close in prayer this morning. Ask God to seal some things in our heart that we might be content in all areas. Mighty God, we love you so much. We love your word, the power of it. This series in Philippians has been amazing. You've taught us so many great things. You've taught us about our heart condition and our mindset and not to be anxious about things. And today, Lord, in closing this thing, you tell us that this contentment reality in all situations has a lot to do with how we enter this matter of giving and receiving. It's tied up. And you told the Philippians, you only told it to them, you didn't say it in other churches, but these ones who did give, these ones who did put you first, you told them in context, because of what you've done, because of your help and you putting God first, because of what you've done, the response to them was this great promise. Now, because you've done that, my God is going to supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory. And he made that promise to people who are God-first people. And Lord, I just pray that we would be those kind of people. Let us all be God-first people. Show us what it means to be selfless in this area. Show us what it means to trust. Some of us, Lord, we have a background in things maybe of not trusting and maybe bad experiences in finances, but show us how to trust you in your word and putting you first, to not just believe in your kingdom, but to get behind your kingdom, to invest in your kingdom. Show us how to engage you in these levels, God, which I know are foreign to some today. But I'm just here to teach the full counsel today, God, and I believe this is something that you're saying it's time. And as we get busy in this Christmas season of running around and buying gifts and getting gifts, I pray we'd remember it's your birthday. And I just pray that we would take our finances in this season and say, now is the time. I'm consecrating my finances. Today is the day. I'm consecrating my finances. And I've never asked this before, but I want to ask if you sense the Lord calling you as he shows me these areas in my life that maybe it's parenting with my kids where he'll say, I need you to do it my way, do it this way. I have to take and I got to consecrate it, put it on the altar. And I trust you find areas in your life with entertainment or other things that as you go down the road with God, you got to put them on the altar. If you feel that finance is an area that today you want to put on the altar with God, I just want to pray for a profound blessing and revelation in your life. If that's you, would you stand up this morning? It's a bold question, but if you want to, it's not an easy. It's close to our heart, but if you feel like you do, and believe, no compulsion. If this is not you, stay, work this out with God. But if it's an area where you're like, I do want to put you first. I want to learn to consecrate. It's not easy, God, but I want to learn to trust. If that's you, I just want to agree with you in prayer. Thank you. Thank you. Lord, I just want to pray, Lord, for those who are standing, they're saying it isn't easy and it doesn't even make sense in the natural, but you offer us a promise and you deserve to be first. So I ask, Lord, that you show us how to be selfless and I ask that you would show us how to be generous and Lord, that we're going to trust you at your word, that you are going to in turn bless us in ways that you know what's best. You may bless us financially. You may bless us with peace. You may bless us with opportunity. You may bless, but you are going to credit things to our account. We're not doing this for the credit. We're doing this because you're worthy. We're doing this because you're simply deserving of all of our praise, and this is an act of worship. But we do want our worship to be pleasing. We want it to go to your nostrils. We want you to smile down and show us, Lord. And I pray for those standing, Lord, that you would give them all a testimony. You would give them all an amazing testimony of being able to say, I tested God and God is true. I tested God at what he said and it is true. And let us be people, God, who from this day forward with this commitment that there would be absolute contentment in the area of finances. And we thank you for that, Father. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
This has been a presentation of Valley Metro Church. We pray that this message has blessed you. To hear more messages or to support future podcasts, please visit us at valleymetrochurch.com.